St. Helena Island. It sits in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, roughly halfway between the western coast of the African continent, with Brazil on the other side. The island is a prison, or at least it used to be for one particular person. This is the location where, after his final defeat in Europe, Napoleon was sent to live his days in isolation. It's also the site of a fascinating development in our understanding of history, and we have Napoleon to thank for it. You see, during his time on this island, he was allowed to have limited visitations. In particular, one person came and engaged him in the discussion of history. And it is this discussion of history that offered up Napoleon's viewpoint on history that has become rather infamous and well-known within society. Napoleon argued that when history, or rather the events that would later be called history, are happening, history doesn't exist. Instead, he argued that it's only after the fact, that after time has passed and things have been agreed upon, that history comes into an existence. In essence, he states that history is nothing but a fable agreed upon. Now, I've heard this idea before. When I was young, when I was a kid, I spent my summers in southeastern Kansas, and my great aunt, who was a ferocious reader and a historian in her own right, used to school me with the same line over and over. History is an agreed-upon pack of lies. Now, this was a particularly formative thought for me as a young person and as a burgeoning historian. But in recent years, I've come to find that it is perhaps a bit limited in its understanding of historical thought and its importance. And that brings me to what I'm going to talk about today. The title that I'm going to talk about is Historical Thinking, the Necessity of an Unnatural Act. Now, there's been a great deal of good research on the subject of historical thinking and it being an unnatural fact coming out of thought, or coming out of Stanford. However, today I'm going to talk about how we can go beyond this and think about its importance in our everyday lives. So let's talk about how we naturally understand the world. This is a pretty accurate model. We tend to think of the world revolving around us. We'll quarrel with that. That's pretty normal and everybody does it. However, it does create a biased understanding of the world. Think of it. When you encounter something, you typically approach it with your memories, your experiences, your emotional state at the time, you. Now, I'm going to offer up a slightly different version of thinking about the world, and it comes from history. The literal translation of the word history means to lead outward, which means that by definition, history as a discipline is meant to make us go beyond our comfort zone. It's meant to make us consider the world first, to think about what we're seeing, to ask questions, to probe it for understanding, and only after doing that process, then do we return to ourselves to reckon with it. In essence, history as a discipline is a discipline in uncertainty, doubt, but above all else, personal growth. Now, we need to approach history with a revised or updated definition. So here's what I often tell my students every year. History is not the agreed upon past, but rather a debate about the past. If we truly want to inspire personal growth on an individual level, we have to challenge our assertions and question what people tell us. Today, I'm going to offer up a particular debate and share it with you. The best debates when discussing history typically fall into one of two categories. The subject is either complex and difficult to understand, or it's controversial. I'm going to choose the latter for my discussion this afternoon. Controversy. I'm going to give you a quote. The quote will be controversial, and I want you to try and attempt to move past your initial visceral reaction. Instead, see what lies before you and perhaps think about who might have expressed this idea. The quote reads, "I have no purpose to introduce political and social equality between the white and black races. There is a physical difference between the two, which in my judgment will probably forever forbid their living together in perfect equality. Race is an all-important discussion and an all-important subject that we should consider more often in our lives and in our conversations with others. This statement takes a bold stance, one that you may disagree with, and rightfully so. But you may be surprised to see who said it. Abraham Lincoln. Now, in this debate and in this consideration of history, it's not fair to say that we best understand Lincoln's ideas and views on the subject of race from one instance and one quote. We have to broaden our scope. So, let's consider that. Let's consider the context of the world that Lincoln lived in. It was very much a society that was torn and divided on the subject of race, and it was certainly a society that was rooted in race-based hierarchy. Sounds a little too familiar in these days, in these times as well. "God hath made the Negro to serve and the white man to rule" was a common sentiment expressed among the white community at that time. And on the opposing side to this, you have the great works of abolitionists, both black and white, who were fervently opposed to it and argued in favor of considering race-based hierarchy to be ridiculous, and instead we should consider equality. This is the world that Lincoln lived in. Now, there's a couple other things we should consider about Lincoln and this particular quote that I've shared with you. It's taken from a speech from the now famous series of speeches known as the Lincoln-Douglas debates. Lincoln and Stephen Douglas were engaged in a campaign for a Senate seat in the state of Illinois. There's a few things you should know about this. The state of Illinois at that time legally did not uphold the institution of slavery. It wasn't permitted within the borders. But legally, it did permit racial segregation, discrimination, under a form of laws that are racist and known as black codes. Now, in addition to that, the audience that Lincoln and Douglas were speaking to were overwhelmingly white, as voting at that time was reserved within the white community, specifically among men. Now, in defense of Lincoln and what he did say in that speech, it should be noted that he did speculate and suggest that perhaps there was grounds for natural rights, regardless of race, among all men. But this is just one moment in the context of the life of Lincoln. If we go back earlier in his life, a few decades prior, and what we have is a personal letter that Lincoln wrote to a friend, a confidant. This gives us a good look into perhaps the thinking of Lincoln at that time. He was riding on a steamboat through the slave state of Kentucky at the time when he observed a chain gang of Negro slaves at rest. They were laughing, telling jokes with one another. They were at ease, playing games. And Lincoln offered up a cryptic statement in his letter. He said, "How true is it that God renders the worst of human conditions tolerable?" Now, more often than not, we know of Lincoln's escapades later on when he's President Lincoln in 1863, when we have the establishment of the Emancipation Proclamation. Classrooms often champion the story of Lincoln as the savior of African Americans and the great emancipator. But even this document is a little cryptic in what it says as well. He asserts a benevolent God and invokes the grace of God in his decision to do this action. But he also states that he believes his acts are of sincere justice. Yet the decision, the Emancipation Proclamation, only applies to the states that were in rebellion against the United States federal government, not entirely to the slaves living within the U.S. It's a lot to reckon with, and this information truly only scratches the surface of the issue. At this point, there must be a series of questions that are tumbling through your head. But probably chief among them is this question. Was Lincoln racist? I chose the image on this slide for a deliberate reason. I felt obligated to do so. I walk past this image every day. It's an image that graces the hallways of the upper school, and there are numerous copies of it. In a community that values honesty, I think it's important to have honest conversations about the nature of history, what we talk about in historical discussions, what we think about important subjects like leadership, race, and above all else, a discussion of what we think about it, both in the past and in our present. How else can we be expected to grow as individuals and to grow as a community? And the importance of that growth is that in order to achieve progress within it, our ambitions to achieve that growth have to match the level of thinking and the level of thought that we apply to such subjects. How else can we expect to truly achieve that growth? But what happens? What happens if we don't apply ourselves to that task? Well, we'll succumb to the simplicity of understanding history that Napoleon offered up in his quip, and other similar generalizations that I've heard time and again in history classrooms where people offer up this idea that history merely repeats itself. In doing so, we become isolated from better ideas, better understandings, and potentially better actions. In effect, we become as isolated as Napoleon was on that island of St. Helena. And so, I urge you all to keep in mind the original intent and the original meaning of history, to view it as something that leads you outward. This isn't just my title, this is your moment for improving your understanding in your everyday life beyond the classroom. And so I urge you, don't back away from this moment. Step up and grow personally. Thank you.